Thank you very much, Francesco. I will try to divide my time, so I'll both talk about why I think the public understanding of science is important, and then I'll tell you more about cosmic dust than you might ever know that you wanted to know, and hopefully it will make you realize that it's very exciting. So I became a professor of public understanding of science last year at Copenhagen University, and even though it's a very sort of well-tried title outside Denmark, it's a new title within Denmark, but so I don't have any sort of colleagues in public understanding of science in Denmark, but I have some very well-known colleagues out in the world who I can look at and try to get inspired. And the reason that I'm very happy that we got such a professorship in Denmark is actually that in Denmark we have a very long tradition for actually doing public understanding of science, and especially of the hard sciences of physics, which I come from. So here you see Niels Bohr, Ørsted, Ole Rømer, and Tycho Brahe, who were sort of my predecessors. So astronomy, for interesting reasons, had a very long tradition in Denmark, and it's always been a bit of a mystery. Why is it that Denmark and the Netherlands, they have some of the best astronomers in the world and the longest traditions, considering that it's countries where it always rains and it's always cloudy? And that, of course, has to do with they were merchants, and they needed to sail the oceans, so they needed to be able to navigate after the stars, so they needed good astronomers. So for me, natural science actually did start in Denmark, because it started on the island of Ven with Tycho Brahe. And Tycho Brahe, he was sitting at his observatory out at Ven, where he for the first time observed a new star in the constellation of Cassiopeia, where he saw a new star and he called it Stella Nova, and it turned out to be a supernovae. And the reason that that's an important observation is that that was the first time that people seriously realized that the sky is not static, that actually things happen. You have stars that arrive and stars that disappear. So Tycho Brahe's stellar nova was there for about a month. We hear a lot about Tycho Brahe, but I want to emphasize that he actually had a sister, Sophie Brahe, and they actually worked together, and actually that women have been contributing to science for several hundred years. But typically, you always talk about Tycho Brahe like he was a single man, but he had all these apprentices of typically young men, but also a few women, especially if it was a sister, a wife, or a mother, or a daughter, who turned out to be good at doing science, then they actually also contributed. And the work that Tycho Brahe did, besides actually study the heavens, was very much like what we do today, because he actually also did a lot of public outreach in his own special way, because he traveled around Europe and then he tried to educate the kings, just like those of us doing public outreach try to educate the ministers and the royalties and the people with the money, and try to convince them that they should keep sending money towards science, because science is a worthwhile thing to fund for various reasons. So he did private tutorials with the different kings, and at that time, the king had all the money, right? All tax went to the king. So when you hear, for instance, Danish politicians today say that we have never spent so much money on science as we do today, because we spent 1% of the BNP on science, which you can debate, because the SU and the buildings and other things are within that number, so actually it's more like 0.6. And they say never have we spent more than that. Is actually not true, because Christian IV, who funded lots of what Tycho Brahe did, he actually spent 1% on the BNP on Tycho Brahe himself as the single. So we have spent a lot more, not on a total amount of money, but in a lot more ambitious when it comes to science early on. So what Tycho Brahe, he studied was a supernovae. So he saw this star and he tried to understand why the stars appear in the sky, why they disappear. And thanks to technology development, we can now look at Tycho Brahe's supernova in X-rays, and we can actually see that this is the star that he saw back then. It looks like this in the optical, and it looks like this in X-ray. And that is why astronomers, when they talk about lights, then remember that we are very inclusive. We love all types of lights. So for me, X-rays, gamma rays, microwaves, and radio waves is also light. It's not just optical light. What I like about Tycho Brahe is that he was also the founder of what I would call the scientific methods. So before that time, people discussed, they read Aristoteles, they read the Bible, and they tried to conclude what the world was like, and Tycho Brahe was actually, let's go out and do some measurements and actually test nature. And at that time, they had two competing theories about how the world was how the world was looking for being an astronomer. So there was the one sort of model of the solar system where you had Earth in the center, and then you had the moon around, and you had the sun, and you had all the planets, and everything was orbiting around the Earth. And then you had the Copernicus, who had suggested maybe it was the sun who was in the center and all the planets were orbiting the sun. So there was a big dispute, was it the Earth who was in the center or was it the sun who was in the center? And Tycho Brahe was the first person who actually systematically, at least as far as we know, set out to measure and observe the orbits of the planets to determine, is it actually the Earth who is in the center or is it the sun who is in the center of the solar system? And his idea was that if it is the sun who is in the center, then you should be able to see the Earth move around the sun. So his idea was that if you have the sun in the center, you have the Earth orbiting the sun, then when you look at the stars on the heavens, and then assuming that the stars probably have different distances, then some will be closer to us and some will be further from us, and that means if we observe, for instance, here in the spring, and then half a year later observe the same star, then we'll be actually be seeing it on a background of another star, which is due to the orbit of the Earth around the sun. So you would actually be able to determine the movement of the Earth based on observing the same star with high accuracy. So he did that measurement, and his conclusion was that he could actually not determine that the Earth was moving around the sun, but he could also see that the other model where you had the Earth in the center and the sun around the center didn't quite work, because when he went out to observe Mars, then Mars wasn't quite there in the sky where it was supposed to be according to either of the models. Tycho Brahe, being Danish, Danes love compromises, he came up with a new model where he said, well, how about if we put the Earth in the center, the moon around, and then we put the sun around the moon and the Earth, and then all the planets around the sun, right? So he made sort of a composite model where you had the Earth in the center. And the reason we haven't heard a lot about that model was because based on these observations that Tycho Brahe did, which was a very high accuracy, then he was expelled from Denmark by Christian IV, he went to Prague, he met Kepler, Kepler got hold of the data, or Kepler had already been in Denmark, so they knew each other. And then based on that, Kepler could deduce that the problem with both models was actually the assumption that all the planets and the suns were moving in circular orbits, and if you allowed for elliptical orbits, then everything actually worked out quite nicely with the sun in the center and the planets around. So it didn't last very long, Tycho's model, but it was a very good model because at least it was a model based on scientific methods. So it was wrong, but it was a good suggestion, I think, of the time. And I think that's one of the important things to actually remember to teach people, that scientific method is concluding the right thing based on your data. And then maybe it turns out to be wrong, but that doesn't mean it's bad science. It's still moving science forward. What is not moving science forward is when people cheat. We can't deal with people cheating because that kills science. But as long as we keep concluding the right things on the data, then even if it turns out to be wrong, it's still moving science forward. Tycho Brahe's idea of using this parallaxis method was actually so ingenious that it's used on the Gaia satellite today, and Gaia is mapping 1 billion stars in the Milky Way. So in 1.5 years, we'll have very accurate measurements of 1 billion stars in the Milky Way. We assume there's 200 billion stars, so it means that we will know 0.5% of all the stellar positions in the Milky Way, which is a huge improvement compared to what we have now. So he was right. The reason that he couldn't distinguish that the Earth was moving around the sun was just that the stars are so far away, they're much further away than he expected. So the movement that you have is so small that they actually needed to invent the telescope in order that you could measure this little angle, which is called the parallax. So after Tycho Brahe, we had Ole Rømer, who's also very important for astronomers, because Rømer was the first one to suggest that light has a speed, that it actually takes time for light to travel from A to B. And the way that he did that was actually that he studied the moons of Jupiter. And so he was studying when the moons move behind Jupiter into the shadow of Jupiter, then based on the orbits of Jupiter's moon, he was trying to determine when will they come out on the other side, when will they come out of the shadow, when should they be observable again. And what he realized was that depending on whether the Earth was on the same side of the sun as Jupiter or on the other side of the sun as Jupiter, then there would be a difference in the arrival time of the light from the moon. So he was certain that he had done the correct calculations, and he realized that sometimes the arrival time of the information was later than at other times. So he postulated that difference in measurement was due to that light had to travel the the distance of the Earth orbit, and he was the first one to determine that light had a speed. And that is very fundamental for astronomers, because everything I'm going to tell you about how we interpret the universe is based on the fact that speed has that light has a speed, and we know that speed, and that speed is the highest that anything can move with in the universe. So if that is not true, then nothing of what I'm going to tell you is true. Another one I just want to mention to you is Hans Christian Ørsted. And Hans Christian Ørsted, next year, it's 200 years ago, he made a quite remarkable but quite simple experiment. So you have a battery here, and then you have an electric wire, and then he, for some odd reason, just decided to move this electric wire on across a compass needle, and then he became the first to show that there was actually a correlation between an electric current and a magnetic field. So that was sort of the beginning of electromagnetism as we know it. And one of the things that I think we should learn from Ørsted is that if Ørsted had been a researcher today, I think the head of universities would say, you've got to apply to Innovationsfonden, because we have a problem with candlelights, right? Because candlelights at that time weren't very good. They made a lot of soot, and they didn't give out enough bright light, so it would be great if he could improve with candlelight. He didn't do that. He just had fun. He played a little bit with electricity, and then he discovered there was a correlation between electric currents and magnetic fields. And the fun thing about that is that he had no idea that it was useful, right? But it turned out to be able to do all of this. And at the same time, once we understood what this was about and we got a hold of that physics, then we were actually able to produce a much better candlelight today. So indirectly, he did actually produce a much better candlelight, but not because the politician told him that that was the object of his research, but because they actually gave him free hands to do the research into the basic research that he was driven by, and then eventually good results came out. I want to mention Ørsted for another reason, because he actually also did a lot of public outreach, so he gave a lot of public talks. And one thing that I found really scary about Ørsted was he was so driven about giving public talks and engaging the public in science and making them understand science that he would actually spend his salary renting rooms where he could invite people in to hear his lectures. I am not that dedicated, I would say. But another thing he did was he also introduced 2,000 new words into Danish, because he realized if you're going to talk about science, you need words. But he didn't just stick to scientific words. He also introduced the word butterfly and minorities and other words which he felt was important in order to have a good conversation. A lot of those words we need, we still use today. So women in science, I just want to say a few things about that. So the reason in my own field, astrophysics, that we have approximately 30% professional women in astrophysics had to do with scientific computers, right? Because when you had to keep track of this movement of the stars in the heavens, and you had to figure out how to navigate after the stars, you needed people who were good at calculating. And women at that time were usually very, very good at calculating in their head, because they were usually in the kitchen, and they had really, really weird units and of measures when you were, and all the recipes were for like one person, so they had to be able to add it up to the number of persons in the household and to add all these different things, so women were quite good. The reason that women got in was a little fun story from Howard University, where you have Pickering here, and he had his young apprentices, a bunch of young men who did all his calculations, and he was quite unhappy with one of the young men because he was a little too sloppy with his calculations. So one day Pickering got really angry and he said, I bet you that my housekeeper could do it better. And then the young man said, I bet that you're wrong. So they had to invite in the young housekeeper, and she had to do the calculation. And she turned out to be much better. And one thing that Pickering hadn't realized was that the good advantage of women was that they only needed half the salary, so he could get two women for the price of one man. So it turned out to be very useful to actually have women in. They were very diligent. They did a good job, and they did it for half the price. So he actually got his own little computer center of women who made the catalogs that we use today for stars. And lots of these women got curious about what they were actually looking at, and they invented all kind of stellar spectral systems and things based on what they found. So scientific computers, also in particle physics with all the tracks, they also had a lot of women scientific computers who did all the calculations before the engineers invented the electronic computer we use today. So one outcome of that was actually the first woman who ever held a permanent science position at a university in Copenhagen was Julie Marie Winter Hansen, who was a Danish scientific computer. who was just waiting for the politicians to pass a law where you were allowed to hire women at universities, and then she got the job, and you have not been able to get rid of women ever since. Can I just tell you a little anecdote which I love about universities? What I like about universities is we keep records. We have meetings, and then we keep records of what people say. So if you go back at the minutes of the meetings that they had at Copenhagen University 100 years ago, when the professors were discussing, should we open the doors for women, right? And it's a good question, and they were discussing, and lots of the professors said, there's no reason to, because women are not likely to come in with any new research ideas, right? Because the research they were doing at that time was physics and theology and philosophy, and that didn't really have the interest of women. So what were they going to bring to the table that would be new? So for political reasons, they decided to bring in women anyway, and it turned out they were absolutely right, right? Because what interests women was education and nutrition and other things. And if you look at universities today, the women really did change the universities, right? Because they brought in new faculties. And whether that's good or bad, I don't know. From a society point, I think it's actually quite good. So I'm not sure I'm going to disfavor bringing in women, but just to show you that there's two sides to the coin, they were right. We didn't necessarily get any better physics. Maybe it was more fun. It's always fun, you know, being at work when there's both genders, but else it was the same. So enough about all that history. I'm here to talk about cosmic dust. And the reason that I'm excited about cosmic dust is because you can wonder, if you're an astrophysics, right, you astrophysicist, you get to pick like dark energy, black holes and dark matter. So how on earth do you end up getting really excited about little specks of dust, which are like little minerals flowing in space between the stars? So the reason I ended up there is that because there's not very much cosmic dust in space. Actually, it's only a very small fraction of the Milky Way, which is dusty. And the presence of dust wasn't acknowledged until the 1950s. So before that, people thought that it was just a lack of stars when you had these dark patches. Today, we realize it's clouds of gas and dust who actually block the light of the stars which are behind. So interstellar matter matters, because if there was no interstellar matter, no cosmic dust in the Milky Way would be a billion times brighter. And then as an astronomer, you think that's great, you know, we love bright objects, but actually that's so bright that it would be really a nuisance, because that would actually blind our telescope, so it would be difficult for us to see the more distant galaxies. So, you know, you should be careful what you wish for. You don't always wish for really, really bright objects. So just to show you what does research in cosmic dust look like, because I'm a little of an untraditional astronomer in that aspect, because I spent more time with laboratory instruments and looking down in microscopes than I spent at telescopes looking out into space. And that's because we use observations, but then in order to understand what kind of dust types do we have, we actually do spectral analysis where we take known dust types of known sizes and known morphologies, and then we send them to a spectrometer to see how do these little solid specks of matter interact with electromagnetic radiation, like light, of different wavelengths, so that we can compare them to observations. And then, of course, we do a lot of calculations, and we try to find out what is going on, and, you know, go to conferences and discuss with colleagues. So here it's Nordita, which moved to Stockholm for some political ones, reason that I think we don't really understand. He used to be in Copenhagen when we were there. So the reason that dust is interesting is actually that if you look at the cosmic microwave background radiation, and I can see here, I wrote it in Danish. You should always be worried about reusing old slides, I'm sorry. But it says gamma, X-ray, optical, infrared, micro, and radio. And so this is like wavelength, and this is the amount, the number of photons, so this is just flux. So if you look at the wavelength from, so this is all the radiation you can get from the universe if you look in any direction and you measure with different instruments. So this is your gamma radiation, your X-ray, your optical, infrared, and microwave and radio, and you can see most of the photons that we receive from the universe by far is the microwave background radiation. So most of the information that we get at any time is from Big Bang. I mean, it's that is where most of our information is. The next best information we get is in the optical and in the infrared, and here we have the stars shining in the optical, and then we actually have the dust giving us reprocessed stellar light in the infrared. So if we want to understand all the information we can get from the stars, which make up the galaxies, then if we can understand how the dust actually reprocesses this, either by absorption or scattering, then we have a lot more information back on the stars and thereby back on the galaxy and thereby understanding what's going on. So just to show you and maybe a bit of an unusual image of galaxies in the sky. So this is from the Herschel Space Telescope, and it's an infrared observation of distant galaxies, and that means that every little dot you see here is a galaxy consisting of approximately 200 billion stars. And what you see is the heat glow of the dust. And I always find it so funny to talk about heat glow, because the dust in this observation is about 80 Kelvin warm, right? So that means it's the heat glow of something that's minus 200 Celsius, right? So it's like the heat glow of something really cold, but space is really cold. So all these many, many galaxies, right? There's only one way to go. That is to find your brightest students on the in the hall, right? And give them five galaxies each and say, here you go. Look at these galaxies and then tell me, look at the light. Go in, look at the absorption lines and determine the redshift, because since we live in an expanding universe, then the wavelength will be shifted towards the red, and further towards the red, the longer the travel distance of the light is. So by looking at the spectra of the starlight from galaxies, we can actually determine the distance by determining the travel light time, so to speak. So if we don't understand the speed of light, and we have used the wrong model for how the universe expands, then none of these times that I put up here is correct, right? But if we do that and we believe in our model, then this galaxy is 2.6 billion years away, this is 6.8, this is 4.7, 10.2, 8.1, and 10.2, and that means that suddenly we can, from this 2D image, we can actually make sort of a 3D suggestion of what the distributions of galaxies are in space. And based on that, and trying to interpret how the dust is formed in the different galaxies, we can come up with sort of this history of how the evolution of dust in the universe worked. So based on the microwave background radiation, we believe that everything was created in a Big Bang, that the first elements which were created, which gives rise to the actual background radiation, is the creation of hydrogen and helium, which is the first two elements and almost only two elements in the early universe. And based on that, I mean, hydrogen and helium are relatively boring elements, right? This is the 150 years of the periodic table, right? And you can't really do much with hydrogen and helium, but one thing you can do a star, right? Because a star is just a big blurb of hot gas. So from hydrogen and helium, you get the interstellar clouds, and within the interstellar clouds, you get star formation. And then inside the stars, when they, by fusion, produce first hydrogen to helium, then helium to carbon, carbon to oxygen, oxygen to silicon, silicon to iron, and then later, as they explode as supernovae, have neutron capture, which gives you the even heavier elements. Then we can sort of write the history in star formation of the different elements and come up with the conclusion that you have the very heavy elements are connected to a supernova because you need the neutron capture in order to explain their existence, while the lighter elements like carbon and nitrogen and oxygen probably originates in stars like the Sun. So your building blocks are done at different timescales because it is such that high mass stars live for a very short time. They're very short lived because they produce a lot of energy, so they use up their fuel very fast. Low-mass stars live on a very long time scale, so billions of years, so they have a very slow production rate. So what you actually have is that you have sort of a fast production rate of the heavier elements, but you have very few high-mass stars. You have many of these, but they are on a much slower time scale. So it's a bit like women and men on panels in science, right? That you have the men, you have lots of them on a slow time scale, and then you have very few women, fewer them on a fast time scale. So that means that the universe, as time goes, is getting more and more enriched or more polluted, depending on your view on the matter, with heavier elements. So you start out with hydrogen and helium, and then you get more and more of the heavier elements. Since little dust particles are mainly made of heavier elements, they're made of carbon and silicon and oxygen and iron and magnesium, that actually means that you should assume that you have no dust in the very early universe, and it will take a while before you get the dust form. First you have to get the elements formed, then you have to have them form little dust specks, and then you can get the dust to clump together and form planets. So the big question is, how long did it take to make enough dust that you can make the first planet like Earth, right? So what is the time scale on that? That's what we're trying to find out. So just some basic cosmic dust facts, just based on the Milky Way. So 1/5 of the baryonic mass, and the baryonic mass means everything which is not dark matter, right? So it's what is made up of the periodic table. So 1/5 of that mass of the Milky Way is dust and gas. So 1/5 of the mass of the Milky Way is in stars, right? Of that 1/5, then 99% is gas and 1% is dust, right? So in some respect, the Milky Way is any housewife's big dream about having something completely clean, because there's very, very, very little dust. But because the dust absorbs the radiation so well, it actually blocks the light very efficient. So we should be quite happy that there's not more dust, because that would make observations really, really difficult. But on the other hand, we want enough dust so we can explain the existence of planets. So when I say dust, what I actually mean is the little smoke particles. They're primarily, we believe, made of carbon, oxygen, silicon, magnesium, aluminum, and iron. And the reason we think that these are the main elements is because that's what we get out of our theoretical calculations of stellar evolution, saying this is the main elements the star produce. When we look at the abundance of elements in the gas space, so the things which are not in dust but actually floating around, then these are the elements that we see are depleted in the gas space. So they're sort of missing, they are not very abundant in the gas space. And then we think, since our stellar evolution models tell that they should be there, and we don't see them in the gas space, they must be in dust. So that's how we determine the dust. But that is just sort of, so actually the sort of the acknowledgement of dust in the universe is the lack of light and the lack of elements, and based on that we think then they must be there and what they're made of. So that's why it makes sense to go to the laboratory, right, and try to understand, okay, how do light interact with different types of dust and different mineralogies and different crystal structures, so that we can get a better high resolution image and compare to the observations and determine exactly what type of dust is it. Because for instance, carbon, right, which is a relatively simple element. It's a lovely element, right? Because if you just have carbon, you can build all kind of wonderful things just out of carbon. But if you think about it in a dust context, then you can either do graphite or you can do diamond. And they have very extreme different optical properties, right? Because graphite, due to its layered structure where you have electrons running here, it's a good conductor in one direction, right? It's an insulator in this direction, but a conductor in that direction, means that it's actually completely opaque, it's black. But also due to this structure, then it's very fragile, it's very easy to break apart because you have the electron cloud not actually binding the individual layers together very well. Then you have diamond, which is also just made of carbon atoms, right? It's just a different way of doing a bond. And they're completely transparent, so you can have lots of diamonds in space without them annoying your observation in any way, right? Where you have very, very little graphite, it actually annoys your observation significantly. So you can put at least an upper limit on how much graphite is there, because if there was too much graphite, we wouldn't see anything. So that is just carbon. It can be completely transparent or very black. We assume most of it is probably what we call amorphous carbon, which is just a sort of an odd mix of sp2 and sp3 bonds of different kind of various morphology. So that's carbon. That's complicated enough. Then it gets even worse once we get to what we call silicates, right? And silicates is basically just the sand that you see on the beach. And if you've ever been really bored on the beach, then maybe you have noticed that you have little sand specks which are completely transparent, or you have some which are more brown, or you have some which are very black. And depending on which color they have, depends on how much else than silicon and oxygen do you have. So if you have just silicon and oxygen, you get something which is glass, which is very transparent. If you add in a little bit of magnesium, it gets to be sort of greenish, and if you add in iron, it gets to be black. So the more iron you have in a silicate, the more opaque it's going to be, and the more efficient it's going to be at blocking your light. So that's what we do in the lab. We try to get hold of that. Another information of what kind of dust do you have, right? Because I guess you have the feeling that we're sort of just sitting there guessing, trying to estimate. So do we have any real data, so to speak? And we have a few real data points, because we have meteorites, and meteorites are just rocks that come to us from space. Out of nowhere, it's a sort of a poor man's time machine, so to speak, because most of these meteorites originate from the formation of the solar system, so that means they're 4.56 billion years old. And if we look at the most primitive meteorites, so the ones which have not been part of a major body, so they're not been included in an asteroid or any of the planets that we know of in the solar system, they're just sort of little building material that just kept to be little rocks forever. So what they consist of is just the cosmic dust which clumped together in the formation of the early solar system, and is somehow a little time traveling pocket of what the material looked like when the solar system formed. And within such meteorites, we find some dust particles which have isotopic compositions which are completely different from what we find otherwise in the solar system. So we think, okay,
this isotopic composition indicates that we have some stardust. These are little specks of stellar dust that originated from stars that died before the solar system was formed, so we can get a measure of what type of dust did the different types of stars produce. What we find is, we find little specks of diamonds, they're very small, they're 1 to 2 nanometers. We find silicon carbide, which is basically what you find on sandpaper if you ever sort of remodeled your house. Then we have graphite, which is very robust, and we find aluminum oxide, which is what is also called sapphire, right? So you can have two approaches to this. You can think, oh, that's lovely. Stars, they actually sprinkle little gems. They're all into sort of jewels. But you could also have the more sort of biased view and say, okay, how do we actually get these dust grains out of our sample? And what we do is we take the meteorite and then we boil it for 4 months in acid, of all kind of nasty acids. And that means that everything we have left once we've done that is all the acid-resistant dust phases. So the fact that we find the acid resistant has to do with our experiment, but at the same time, the fact that you have little dust particles that were made in a star, has traveled in interstellar space for God knows how long, then became part of the solar system and been there for 4.5 billion years, probably indicates that you're only going to find the more robust dust types. So we don't find very much amorphous carbon, but that doesn't mean amorphous carbon wouldn't be there, because first we know we're going to kill it in our experiment, but even it was probably killed at an earlier time. So that's actually what I'm trying to answer in one of the projects that I'm running at the moment, where we sit with an atomic force microscope and we actually take the meteorites and then instead of boiling them in acid so that we know we only have the really acid resistant phases left, we take the meteorite and we break it apart, so we look at the inside of a meteorite and we try not to contaminate it too much before we look at it, and then we try to look at the different carbon phases to find out which carbon phases were present in the early solar system, what type of carbon did you have. And then by sort of coincidence we found something else that we're currently looking into, which we think has the potential of being interesting, let's see. And that is that within some of the dust grains that we have from the meteorites, we find dust within dust, so to speak. So we find tiny dust grains inside a larger dust grain. And we think that if you have a tiny dust grains which worked as a seed for a larger dust grains, then you have it completely encapsulated and it's sort of it's sitting there, and you might have something which is more pristine than the surrounding dust grain. So we're actually trying to measure on these dust within dust, hoping it can give us some information about the very, very early dust and maybe dust that originated from before the solar system. So this is just to show you that we've done X-ray tomography where we sort of can view, I mean, technology, engineers are amazing, right, sometimes. I mean, so 10 years ago you couldn't do that, so here you can see the dust grain up here, but you can just sort of do X-ray tomography through your little dust grain. So this is 5 micron, right? So this dust grain is relatively big, it's like 20, 25 micron, right? But the dust grain inside is really, really small, but it's still big enough that we can actually see it in the X-ray tomography and find out how big it is and what is the morphology. And then what we see is that around these dust grains you have little loops of vacuum, so we can determine the volume fraction and determine the temperature that this dust had once it was encapsulated into the dust grain. So another project that I'm working on, which just came in by coincidence, is actually that we have the Juno spacecraft that flew out to Jupiter. And one thing they had not thought about, but which turned out to be a really good coincidence, was that they decided, so the engineers were eager to test how far out can you fly solar panels, because the further away you get from the sun, the less radiation you have, and you need a certain amount of electricity in order to drive your scientific instruments on board the spacecraft. Traditionally, they have done this by having little nuclear reactors on board of the spacecraft, but due to people's dislike of nuclear power plants and we don't use nuclear weapons that much anymore. There is actually a shortage of plutonium on the sort of normal market. So it's difficult to buy plutonium for the space missions at any reasonable price. So they decided they were going to use solar panels. So what you see here are very big solar panels. And this mission was sent out from Earth, it's called Juno, out to Jupiter. And then in order to navigate in space, because that's always problematic, finding out what direction are you flying and in what direction is your antenna pointing, because you want it to point towards Earth, and Earth is just a little speck when you're out at Jupiter, you always have to know where you are. So to do that, they have something called star mappers. So they basically have four cameras pointing in different directions, looking at geometrical patterns of the stars, using the maps from the Hipparcos and Gaia satellite, which use Tycho Brahe's method of parallaxes to find out where they are. So these little cameras, they're sitting there looking, and what they observed was actually that the solar panels seem to be like a bit butterfly net that actually caught a lot of dust particles on their way out to Jupiter. So I was called up with people from DTU saying, we have a problem, Houston, because we don't have enough electricity once we arrive to Jupiter, but we have some really lovely data of a lot of dust particles actually flying to these solar panels. Will you come look at them? So right now we're trying to understand where is the dust, because this is the first in situ measurement of the amount of dust from Earth out to Jupiter that nobody planned, nobody designed, but just by coincidence. This is an image that Juno took of Jupiter, because the main idea of the mission was actually measure Jupiter's magnetic field and make high resolution infrared pictures of the atmosphere to understand the atmospheric features on Jupiter. And the big scientific question that Juno is trying to answer is actually, is Jupiter a gas planet consisting just of gas, or do you have an Earth-like planet, a solid core inside on the size of the Earth? Because one interesting thing about planet formation that we don't know is, are all planets almost a similar size? Some just have more atmospheres than others. Is that the way to view planets? Or do we have two distinct groups of planets where you have like Earth-like terrestrial solid planets, and then you have gaseous planets, which are more to be considered like small scaled down stars, but with too small and too cold and not dense enough to become stars? So are they like unsuccessful stars, or are they just like Earth-like planets with too much of an atmosphere? So that's actually the real sign Juno is after. But here's the measurement where you can see time on its way from Earth or out towards Jupiter, and here the dashed line shows you where the asteroid belt is positioned. And one thing that really surprised us was that we measure most dust particles outside the asteroid belt. We would have expected we would have more dust inside the asteroid belt than between the asteroid belt. So we're trying to understand what we're seeing here.
Also the Pioneer satellites had small windows that could be penetrated by dust.
Yes.
So yep. One didn't know this from the Pioneers?
Yeah, so they didn't know that there was dust. So they knew there were dust. It's just that dust is not that exciting, so nobody's going to build a space mission. And these people were interested in Jupiter's magnetic field. They never intended to measure dust. It was just a coincidence. They did.
Had small dust detectors.
Yeah, they had dust detectors, right? But that's just finding something small. So we have that measurement, and then we have the Ulysses satellite, which actually measured. That was quite interesting. It measured just dust coming orthogonal down on the solar system plane. So that means interstellar dust. How much dust is actually passing through from the Milky Way as the Milky Way moves through the, no, we try again, as the solar system moves through the disk of the Milky Way. So that's another measurement, but this is the longest measurement where they actually had quite a big surface area, because they're really big, these solar panels, up from Earth and out to Jupiter. So just to show you a nice image of cosmic dust, so this is the Andromeda Galaxy. The Andromeda Galaxy you can see by naked eye. This is what it looks like in the optical. This is what it looks like in the infrared. So all the dust particles you see in galaxies are, which is determining the spiral structure of galaxies. So the dust particles are actually where you have the spiral galaxies, and this is what it looks like when you put the two images on top of each other. So the thing that we are trying to do by theoretical modeling is that we are trying to look at all these observations, and then we're trying to do models saying, okay, what happens if you only look at the evolution of a galaxy from Big Bang to today, just considering that it's full of stars, and what happens if you look at it and you consider that it's full of stars and dust, and what kind of model do you get, and how fast can you actually get, how much heavy elements do you need before you can form the first dust specks? Is there sort of a minimum amount of elements that you need before you have enough that you start forming dust or not? So I hope that gave you some sort of insight that we're trying to attack dust. It's part of a big cosmic cycle where you actually have that red giants and supernovae as part of their end evolution produce the elements and little specks of dust that triggers star formation and planet formation. We see it in our own solar system. It comes in as meteorites. Once the sun is no more, then everything will go back into the big cosmic cycle. So that's the big cosmic cycle we're trying to explain by studying these specks of dust. So when I meet politicians and I tell them this, and I'm very excited, and they think, what is it good for? I mean, why should I pay you salary for studying cosmic dust? You know, what does it do? What good of the universe does it do? And so I always mention this thing with Ørsted's experiment and say, well, you never know what good it's going to do, but I'm sure it's going to do you some good because we understand something. But another thing I would like to share with you guys, because I think it's important that we have to be better at explaining politicians, that is that beside the exciting research, which we are more likely to talk about because that's what makes us excited, then we actually also teach. And they know that, they have understood that, because they know their students, and you know, and students need their SU, and students are voters, so they're aware of this. But we actually also do a lot of other extremely important things where we spend a significant amount of our time that the politicians are completely unaware of, and which is extremely important for the integrity of science and the fact that people actually trust scientists. And that is that we act as referees on scientific journals, we are in evaluation panels of who gets the money, we evaluate PhDs to make sure that the students are smart enough and that we guarantee that they're smart enough. And we are external examinators at other universities, and God knows, not all of this is fun, right? Sometimes it's fun, but a lot of time it's just a lot of hard work, and it takes a lot of time. But it is extremely important because that is the way we keep science in check, so that we can always say that we do good science and we agree on what good science is and what good science means. And thanks to this, then if you look at when people, so this is a survey done in the UK, and I think maybe politicians, which are down here, have fallen down even further in the UK since then. But it's quite interesting because the good news is that all this extra work we do is actually acknowledged that people do trust scientists, right? And it's very nice to see that we're up there, and it's very good to see the teachers and doctors and nurses are actually also highly evaluated citizens of society. But it's very worrying, I think, that the people who actually decide what our working conditions are going to be like and how much money we're going to be and how the university politics are going to be and how things are going to be run, they're down here. So these are the people who determine the frames for how we're going to do our work, right? So that's worrying, but it's very good for us that we are up here. And since we're scientists and we strive for excellence, then we can discuss whether 85% is good enough, should we try to get a little higher, right? Being a scientist, you always want to look at sort of timelines, right? Because you're thinking, okay, this was 2017, was that just lucky year? You're just showing your best data to get your best image or what? But actually, if you look here, so here's a timeline from 1983 up to 2017, then you can see that it's actually an upgoing trend for professors and scientists. We are actually only getting better at this, so that's very good. So we are doing the right things. You can worry a bit about journalists, right? The ones who actually talk about our science, they are not getting better at this. So therefore, I think peer review is extremely important. It's important we do peer review, but we might have to reconsider the way we do peer review because it's very good. It's not perfect, but it's very good. The problem is it's extremely time consuming. And the fact that we all, in order to get money, have to produce more papers means that more papers need to be refereed. And I think we are reaching some sort of limit where we're all dying from refereeing papers, and we're thinking, if I have to referee all these lovely papers, then how am I going to have time to write my own, right? So of course you can say, well, then there's a balance, right? At some point, there is a limit to how much we can publish. But I think we have to consider, how can we do this in maybe a better way? Then of course, what we are catching is misconduct, right? That is what we don't want to see. So that is why it's important. Then another threat is actually predator journals, right? I mean, who ever thought that you could make money out of scientists? But it shows you how terrible we are at business, right? We write an article for free, then we hand it over to a journal, and we even pay them to print it, right? And then they get money from selling our article, and we are not even allowed to reuse the quotes or the images or anything, right? So then we are misconducting. So there's something interesting there that one needs to also work at. Then I think we also really have to discuss academic funding, because I think we have reached a point where we can discuss, is it a blessing or is it a threat? So I know the finances of Copenhagen University this year, 2019, for the first time we have what we call a crossover. So before we always had a little more of what you call basic money from the government than external money from foundations, and this year we're crossing over, so now we have more external money from the foundations and less from the government. And that's a new situation, and how do you keep your integrity if you at the same time convince Gunbeck that, oh yes, you think I do cosmic dust, but actually I do astrobiology and it's very important for brain research, so you should just fund me. Then I think our biggest threat is actually the way that we treat young people. I think that the whole job market is absolutely horrendous. And I think it's unethical that we produce all these PhD, we promise them they can do important science, and at the same time we have a cut in the number of jobs. So the young men feel that they're getting cheated because they feel that all the young women are getting favored with all this talk about young women should also get in there. The young women feel they get cheated because all young men gets the position because that's the way it's always been. Both are correct and none of them are correct, because the truth is that we produce more PhD than we did when I was young, but we have less positions now because of since 2008 with the crisis. Then since a number of jobs is correlated with BNP, there's just less jobs but more smart young people. So it's much tougher getting a job today than it used to be. And I think that it's almost unethical the way that we treat young people, that we have them travel the world, we promise them nothing, and we basically exploit them, and then we kick them out for no good reason at all, and not because they're not good. So I think that's something we as a scientific community, we can't get politicians to solve this for us. We have to find a way of solving this, and I think we can do this. Then there's one thing when it comes to public outreach, and I'm sure all of you have tried this, and there's the difference between opinions and facts, right? So what is just my opinion? I've given you a few opinions here, and what is facts? And that is one thing that really annoys me, because I am, for instance, invited to go on TV and talk to a flat earther, right? The Flat Earth Society, for some reason, has a huge rise. You don't get it. I mean, I don't get it. I'm thinking, how can anyone think the Earth is flat, right? And you meet them in a TV studio, and you say, well, the Earth is clearly not flat because the sun sets, right? And it gets bigger, as I said. And they say, no, the sun doesn't set. It moves into the horizon. And you say, but if it moved into the horizon, it would get smaller. And it doesn't get smaller, it gets bigger. You know, it clearly doesn't work. And gravity problems and the rest of the objects in the universe around, but not Earth. So there's all kind of interesting problems. And that's actually one thing I think we should all be very careful about, because journalists, they like a good debate, what they think is a good debate. So here is Dr. Jenkins of the National Institute of Health, who will talk about the results of 3 years of study. And then for a different take, we have Roger here, who I understand has reached the opposite conclusion just by sitting on his couch and speaking. And I think there's a lot of sort of outreach done by journalists which is done in this way, and I think we actually have to put our foot down and say, no, we don't want to do this. I mean, I'll be happy to have a debate with someone who is interested in going into a debate and actually reach some sort of consensus like we do in science. I think that's when science is best. That is when we have good scientific discussions and both people move their opinions somehow. But we are not going to do it if it's just this, it looks great on TV, people want to kill each other, but nobody gets any smarter, right? And then people go, oh, I saw this guy on TV, he said something completely ridiculous, so that's probably true, right? And I find it alarming.
And what if he's a professor at the theology department, the other guy?
Yeah, then that's a problem. Or even if he's and it's even worse if you're a professor of physics at Harvard, who said that the interstellar asteroid was probably an alien spaceship.
Right, exactly.
And then you get called up by the news, and they say, would you like to comment on the alien spaceship? And I was saying, nope, not really. And they say, why not? And I said, because I don't think it's an alien spaceship. So, and then they say, oh, but that's great, you can come on TV and say it's not an alien spaceship. I said, but I cannot say it's not an alien spaceship because I don't know. I can just say it's not very probable it's not an alien, that it is an alien spaceship. It's least probable. So I explained to them what I wanted to say, but they only want to give me 1 minute, and what I wanted to explain took 5 minutes. So we decided that I shouldn't be the one going on TV, so they called one of my colleagues who were happy enough to say that something that could be said in 1 minute, right? So I find it a bit scary and interesting that NASA, who currently has an orbiter orbiting the moon and mapping the moon in great detail in order to get a high resolution map for future manned missions on the moon, they actually need to spend research money on getting a very detailed map of the 6 landing sites of former manned missions. So this is Apollo 11, Apollo 12, Apollo 14, 15, 16, and 17, just to prove to people that we've been on the moon. Because people have this conspiracy, they think we've never been on the moon. And my take on it is that I love people who think we have not been on the moon, because that must mean they love mankind, right? Because you are imagining that 1,000+ people can keep a secret, and that they are willing to keep a secret. And I find it very hard to keep a secret. I know lots of people who find it hard. So how long can you keep a secret? I mean, I would tell my parents, or I would tell my kids, or if you could get 15 minutes of fame by being the one who spilled the secret, I mean, who's not going to do that? So I think it's a great trust in people, actually, these people who believe in conspiracies. But I find it alarming. We spend money on this. And the good news about the astronauts were they just left all their garbage and all the litter and everything on the moon. So you can see like their footprints, that's great, and you can see their wheel tracks, but you can also see all their scientific instruments and the flags and all the other things they just left up there. So hopefully there's no doubt anymore that we have been on the moon. So what I think everybody gets in, as long as they behave scientifically, I think should be sort of our call of keeping each other in check and working for scientific integrity and best practice. And with that, I would say thank you for your attention, and sorry for going over time.